to be you. It had to be you. I wandered around and I finally found the somebody who would make me be.
If we haven't met, my name is Matthew. I'm the lead pastor for Good News Church, and I'm so glad that you're here today with us. We're going through the series that we're calling Love Song. We're going through the book, the Song of Solomon, out of the New Testament. And some people have been giving me some feedback. Some people have told me, you know what, Pastor Matthew? I've had a Bible for many years. I never read that before. I didn't even know that stuff was in the Bible. And that's what we're looking at. As we're going through Song of Solomon. This book talks about love, relationships, sex, marriage, and sexual purity. And so we're going through this series and asking God, God, what do you want me to change in my life to live the way you want me to live in this area of my life? In this area of relationships and sexual purity, is there anything that needs to change? Is there anything you want me to do different? Because God, if there is, I'm all for it. And that's what's happening right now as we're going through this series that we're calling Love Song. Today's message is super practical, super practical. If you put today's message into practice, it will change your life and your relationships. I can guarantee it. Today we're in Song of Solomon chapter 7. So go ahead and grab a Bible. And in the front of every Bible, there's a table of contents to help you find where we're at. Or if you have a smartphone, you can go to YouVersion, YOUVersion.com, type in Song, S-O-N-G, 7. It'll take you to where we are today. Now, some of you are thinking, Pastor Matthew, are you serious? More Song of Solomon? I mean, how long is this book? It can't be much longer. It's not a whole lot longer. Just one more chapter. Next week, we'll finish up this series. But some of you are asking, how long can this possibly be? How long can we talk about relationships and sex and sexual purity? I mean, is there that much more to say? You think I have a lot to say on it. I just read this story recently about this group of monks, okay? Think about this for a second. A group of monks, celibate guys who walked away from the ladies, living on their own. And for 4 years on Sundays, they worked through the book Song of Solomon. For 4 years. We're doing a series for 6 weeks. A bunch of celibate monks by themselves, no ladies around. Have you been listening to the lines we've been reading over the last couple weeks about her twin fawns and all this? And we got the big group of monks talking about this for 4 years. 4 years. 4 years they're talking about this. I'm not sure it was really a good idea. But for 4 years, they were going through Song of Solomon. And you know what? At this point, we've made it farther in Song of Solomon than they did. Because at the end of 4 years, the head monk died. And they had only made it through half of the book. Only half of the book after 4 years. And so the new head monk comes in and he says, you know, guys, let's do the Gospel of John instead, okay? And so they switched over. They walked away from the Song of Solomon, and they went to the book of John. Today, as we're talking about Song of Solomon chapter 7, we're talking about how to close the gap in our relationships. How do we close the gap between our good intentions, the things we meant to do, and what we really do? Because quite often there's a gap between our good intentions, what we plan to do, what we know we should do, what we think we should do. Our good intentions, there's a gap between our good intentions and what we really do, the follow-through. And that's what we're going to talk about today. See, I'd argue that generally, most of us know the right thing to do. Most of the time, we know the right thing to do. But just because we know the right thing to do doesn't mean we do it, huh? We can all start to think of experiences in life, examples in life, when we knew what we should have done, and we're kicking ourselves because we didn't do it. And so today, we're going to ask God, God, help us to close the gap. See, the problem is, we just don't often follow through. And that's what we're going to talk about today, follow through. 2 weeks ago, I was in Mexico. Like Deanna was saying, I was with the team in San Vicente, Mexico. And we were coming back from after a week of serving in migrant camps, after a week of serving in Ensenada, after a week of serving people medically and serving the kids with games and songs. And it was a great week. Great week. We saw God do some really cool stuff. 17 people from our church, from both campuses combined, from Commerce City and Broomfield, we went. We served for a week. Finally, on Saturday, we're coming back. We hop in the vans and we drive north. Driving up the freeway, Highway 1, and then into Tecate, if you've ever crossed the border there, we're waiting in line. And as we're waiting in line to leave Mexico to go back in the States, I think to myself, we're going to be crossing the border in just a minute. I need to turn my cell phone on and call my wife. Because I've been taking these trips for years, and I know that as soon as I cross that border, she wants to hear from me, right? Because if I make that phone call south of the border, it's going to cost us a small fortune, and I'm going to have to sell one of our children, okay? And so I don't do that. And when we cross the border, then I need to turn on my cell phone and give my wife a call and say, hey, we're here, we're doing well, we're alive, we're back in the States. She wants to hear that. I know that. But as we're sitting in line, and I'm waiting for the churro guy to come up to my window and sell me churros through the window, right? As we're waiting in line, I think I need to find my phone. Oh, no. My phone's not in my pocket. My phone's not in the dashboard of the van I'm driving. I pack my phone in my duffel bag with everybody else's duffel bags stacked high in the back of these vans. There's no way I can get this phone right now. And so I'm thinking, oh, man, I meant to call her. I need to call her, but I can't call her right now. And so we continue on. We were in line for over 2 hours, nearly 3 hours. We're waiting in line. I ate a lot of churros, by the way. And so we're waiting in line. And we finally get up to the front, and we go through, and it's a long process to turn in our visas and be back in the States and all that kind of stuff. And then we take the team, and we go, and we stop for some burgers. And I should have gotten into my bags at that point, shouldn't I? You all know this. I should have. But I forgot. I was hungry. I needed real food. Those churros just didn't do me right, and so I needed a burger, right? So we're at In-N-Out, and I'm getting a burger, and we hop in the vans, and we start driving from there to the airport. Because Isaiah, my youngest son, and I were going to fly back before the rest of the team, so I could be with you guys last Sunday morning. And so as we're driving from In-N-Out Burger over to the airport, I think to myself again, oh, I didn't get my phone. I need to call Heather. This isn't good, right? And I know my intention was to call her. I meant to call her, but I didn't. We get to the airport. Isaiah and I jump out of the van. We find bags that have our names on it. Great, we got our bags. We check them in. And then as we're walking to the gate, I think, I need to call Heather. And I've just turned in my phone in my bag. It's gone. I've checked it in. It's gone. And so we get into the airport, and I think, I got to call Heather. So I find this ancient piece of equipment. You may have heard of it before. It's called a pay phone. Anybody ever? Yeah, you might have seen one before. Isaiah, my son just turned 10 today. Today is Isaiah's birthday. He's 10. So he was 9, you know, 10. He's looking at a pay phone. He's like, what's this? How's this work? What do we do with it, you know? And so last time I picked up a payphone, it only took quarters, right, or dimes or something. I don't remember what it took. So they've got a credit card slot in this thing. So I'm sticking my credit card in. I'm trying to make a long-distance call. I'm trying to call Heather. I got a call, right? And it takes my credit card, and it won't connect. And I know I'm going to get, like, that call I should have made while sitting in line that was going to cost me a child. I should have. I'm sure that's what the bill's going to be once this credit card phone call comes through. But it wouldn't connect. It wouldn't connect. It wouldn't connect. It wouldn't connect. Finally, Isaiah and I gave up. We go to sit down. We're in the airport, right? Go to sit down, and I get out my laptop, and I work through to, if you've ever got used internet in an airport, you got to jump through all their hoops. You know, I promise not to do this, and I will do this, and I, you know, all that kind of stuff. I click all those 1,000 I agree buttons, and finally I've got live feed, and so I'm trying to instant message her. Maybe I can connect to her phone, and she'll get it, and I'm sending messages, and I'm not getting anything back. And I'm thinking, oh, no. Either one, it's not going through. Two, she's not answering. Or three, she's not talking to me, right? So I don't know which it is at this point. And so finally, there's nothing I can do. They're calling us at the gate. So I close up the laptop, and I get on the plane. We come, and we land. Some of you are shaking your heads already. I know. You know where this is going, right? And so we land in the airport last Saturday night, a week ago yesterday. It's 11:30 by the time we get our bags. It's after that when she picks us up at the curb. And I had every intention to call her. But you all would agree, intentions aren't good enough. We have to close the gap. When I got to the car, you can imagine, she wasn't quite as happy to see me as she could have been. And rightfully so, right? I mean, I didn't connect with her. It was my fault. I had every intention. And I'm thinking to myself, don't I get points for good intentions? No. We don't get points for good intentions. We want points for good intentions, right? And this is the problem. This is the gap, and this is the problem with all relationships. In relationships, we generally judge others by their actions. We judge others by their actions, and we judge ourselves by our intentions. Don't I get points for trying? I intended to call. Isn't that good? And Heather, my wife, rightly so, says no, you know? She's judging me by my actions. When I do wrong, I want people to judge me by my intentions. I want people to give me some grace. I want people to be understanding. But then when somebody doesn't call me, or when somebody doesn't follow through, I look at their actions and I think, why didn't you? Why did you say that? Why did you? We judge others by their actions, and we want to be judged by our intentions. And so there's a gap there between actions and intentions, the way we judge others and the way we want to be judged. And that's what we're going to talk about today, about this problem. Do you see how this hurts marriages? Do you see how this hurts all relationships, friendships, fiancés, marriages, any relationship? This hurts all relationships. So today it's time to close the gap between intentions and actions, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to ask God to help us close that gap. Let me give you two thoughts on relationships that will change your relationships if you'll follow them out. Number one, when you think of something good, say it. When you think of something good, say it. Say that with me. You guys, say it with me. Ready? When you think of something good, say it. Now, we talked a little bit about this a little bit earlier in this book, because this is what a lot of Song of Solomon is about. When you think of something good, say it. Don't just hold it back. When we hold it back, when we think of something good and we hold it back and we don't say it, it's kind of like buying somebody a present and wrapping it up and then never giving it to them. Why would you do that? But we do that. We think of good things about another person. We think of something great that they did. We think of something we appreciate about them. We think of something that we love about them. And we don't say it out loud. We just hold it in. We rob them of the blessing of receiving it. When Solomon thought of something good, he said it. He didn't hold it back. He said it. He shared it. He gave life to their relationship by saying his good thoughts out loud. Now, if you read the end of chapter 6, if you read the end of chapter 6, right, we're in chapter 7 today, if you read the end of chapter 6, you get the impression that Solomon, his new bride, him and his new bride are having a good time, and she's dancing for him, right? And so she's dancing for him the end of chapter 6, and when she's dancing for him, he starts thinking some good thoughts. And I got to tell you, when my wife dances for me, I think good thoughts too, right? And so she's dancing for him, he's thinking good thoughts, and he's going to compliment her. He's going to start with her feet, and work his way up complimenting her. Let's read Song of Solomon chapter 7, verse 1. He says, "How beautiful your sandaled feet, O princess's daughter. Your graceful legs are like jewels, the work of a craftsman's hand." He's saying, woman, God gave you some beautiful legs. Some curvy, beautiful legs. That's what he's saying there. Verse 2, "Your navel is a rounded goblet that never lacks blended wine." And I read that, and I was like, what in the world does that mean? And so I did a bunch of research. I'm like, what does that mean? I'm reading all these commentaries about a goblet and wine and all that kind of stuff. And after all that time, I still don't know what he means. I don't know. I just figure Solomon's got a thing for his wife's belly button. I think that's about it. I don't know what else to say there. Keep going. "Your waist is a mound of wheat encircled by lilies." He's saying she's curvy and beautiful. Verse 3, "Your breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle." Now, if you've been with us through this series, you might recognize he's already used this line on her once before. And I have a hunch it works so well, he's using it again. I think that's what's going on here. And so he's just repeating it, right? If it works for you, keep using it, right? So he goes on, and he works his way up, and he compliments her neck and her nose and her eyes and top of her head. What's he doing? He's giving life to his good thoughts. He's saying them out loud. We need to speak words of affirmation, admiration, and affection. We need to say them out loud. We need to speak them. Speak words of admiration, affection, and affirmation. We can't just think them. We need to say them out loud. Why are these types of words so important? Admiration, affection, and affirmation. Why are they so important? This is what it says in Proverbs 18, verse 21. It says, "The tongue has the power of life and death." The tongue has the power of life and death. The words you speak have the power of life to give life to that relationship. When you speak words of affirmation, admiration, and affection, they will build up the relationship. They will bring life to the relationship. But your mouth also has the power to destroy that relationship. When we curse that person, when we talk about them behind their back, when we criticize or we slander, we destroy the relationship. We kill it. We bring it to death. And so our mouths are really powerful. So how do we speak words of affirmation, affection, and admiration? I mean, how do you do that? You might be good at poetry. A few of you in this room, you're good at poetry like Solomon is. You could come up with some beautiful lines. But the rest of us were like, I can't talk like that. I don't think like that. I don't know how to say anything like that. So what do we do? What would affirmation and affection sound like for us when we're not Solomon, when we're not slick with our words? Well, you start with that phrase that we use a lot. That phrase is, I love you. You look at somebody that you know and in that relationship and you say, I love you, I like you, you're my friend, you're my wife, you're my husband, you're my bride, I love you. And I remember the first time I said those words to the woman who's now my bride. I remember how tongue-tied I was and how I was so concerned about could I get these words out and what would she say when I told her that I love her and what would she think. And I remember stumbling over those words the first time I told her I loved her. And then she told me she loved me back. And oh my goodness, my heart skipped a beat and it felt so good. And I was on cloud nine. Heather and I have been married for 21 years now. And we dated for 6 years before that. I've said I love you many times. Thousands of times, over a million. I don't know. I haven't counted. But this is the thing that I know. Those words, I love you, are really powerful. Really powerful. But even the most powerful words, when you say them enough, could start to not mean as much as they used to. When you say it after 5 years or 10 years or 15 years, sometimes you don't mean it. Say it with the same meaning. Sometimes you don't say it with the same conviction. Sometimes we don't say it with the same power. Now, that doesn't mean those words aren't important. Doesn't mean that they're not powerful. But sometimes we just tack them on. I'm off to work, honey. Bye. I love you. And we're out the door. That was a great dinner, honey. Love you. And we just tack it on. Love you, love you, love you. And pretty soon they don't have quite the same power anymore. And so how can we use those words to bring admiration and affection, to bring life to our relationship? What would that look like? I would encourage you to add one word onto your I love you statement and watch how it doesn't change the relationship. The word is because. I love you because. And then you fill in the blank after that. I love you because you make me feel special. I love you because you're so much fun to be with. I love you because I couldn't ask for a better bride. I love you because I don't deserve you. I love you because you are special to me. I love you because you're a godly man. I love you because of the way you love our kids. I love you because, and you fill in the blank. And watch how it doesn't bring power to that relationship. Parents, do it with your kids. Kids, I dare you to do it with your parents. Spouses, do it with your husband, do it with your wife. And see that it doesn't change the relationship, that it doesn't bring power back to those words, I love you. I love you because you fear God. I love you because you make me feel special. I love you because I've got a thing for belly buttons. I think that was Solomon's line, right? This is what Solomon was doing. He's saying, I love you because of the way your feet look. I love you because of the way your legs look. I love you because of the way your belly button, your hips look. I love you because. And he's spelling it out very clearly. And those words of admiration and affection are there. You can hear it. Whenever you think of something good, you what? You say it. When you think of something good, you say it. Now, why is this so important? Why is it so important that we say it? Because if we don't say it out loud, if we don't tell them something good, they generally will assume something bad. If we don't tell our loved ones something good, they will assume something bad is happening. For example, 6 months ago, guys, 6 months ago, you told your woman, you told your bride, you look beautiful. You look beautiful. And that was good. That was important. That was 6 months ago. And you've been thinking, well, that was good enough, right? I mean, I told her 6 months ago she was beautiful, and nothing's changed. She's still beautiful. And so you think everything's fine. But guys, you know what's going on in her head? For the last 5 months, 29 days, she's been wondering, doesn't he think I still look beautiful? What's wrong? Does he think that I'm growing old? Does he think I'm gaining some weight? Does he think there's something wrong? And for us guys, we really do think everything's okay. But for the ladies, your lady, your woman, she needs to hear it again and again and again. Not just once, but again and again and again. Because she'll begin to assume, since she hasn't heard you say it again, she'll begin to assume that something's gone wrong. We often, again, this goes back to intentions and actions. Our intention is good. And so we don't say anything. There's nothing wrong. There's nothing to talk about. My intention is good. But my action is read as, there's something wrong. There's quietness here. There's silence here. He doesn't compliment me like he used to. She doesn't encourage me like she used to. And so we begin to believe that something's wrong. And it may be that your intentions are, it may be that nothing's changed. But there's a gap between our intentions and our actions when we're silent. And so we need to speak up. Watch what Solomon does. He starts with her toes, right? And he works his way up, and he gets to the top of her head, and this is what he says. In Song of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 5, he says, "Your head crowns you like Mount Carmel." Now, you may remember Mount Carmel from a couple of months back. We were going through the story of Elijah, the showdown on Mount Carmel. Do you remember that? Mount Carmel is this mountain that sticks up, and from all the kingdom of Israel, you can see it no matter where you are in the kingdom. You can see it out on the horizon, and it's a beautiful mountain, and the top is green and lush because it's some of the most fertile land in that area. He's saying your head is beautiful. Your head is beautiful. Your head crowns you like Mount Carmel. Your hair is like royal tapestry. Your hair is like, now this is way better than the line he used a couple of weeks ago when he said your hair is like goat's hair. Remember that one? So I think that he figured out that one didn't go over so well, and so he kind of changes it up a little bit. He's learning, right? He's learning. This is important. When you've got that relationship, you find out what they like and what they don't like, and you don't use the same bad lines over and over again, okay? And so he says, your hair is like tapestry. It's royal, something that only someone with a lot of money could afford. A tapestry is a rug that you hang on the wall. Rugs go on the floor for the rest of us. Unless you're really rich, then you can take your extra rugs and hang them on the wall, but the rest of us don't have something, a luxury like that. And he's saying, you are luxurious, you are beautiful, you are worth admiring, you're like a piece of art that I could just stare at. That's what he's saying. He says, your hair is like a royal tapestry. The king is held captive by its tresses. Solomon's the king. And he's saying that he is the most powerful man in all the world. And yet this woman in front of him holds him captive. He's saying, I'm your prisoner. He's saying, you've got me all locked up. You are so beautiful. I am yours. He's saying, I'm your love slave. That's what he's saying right there, I think. And then this is how she responds. Verse 10. She hears these words. She hears the affirmation. She hears the affection. She hears the admiration. And she says this in verse 10. She says, I belong to my lover, and his desire is for me. She fully knows that she is the object of his desire. And she says, I'm yours. I mean, this is beautiful. Because of the words he's spoken, not just what he thought, but what he said, she knows that she's loved. And she's secure in the relationship. It gives her strength to be able to say something very intimate like that. And she's secure in the relationship, and she's happy to give herself fully to him. So first, when you think something good, say it, okay? Number one, say it. Number two, when you think something special, do it. Do it. Repeat this with me. When you think something special, do it. Yeah, do it. We need to apply what we're thinking. I want you to watch as they apply two specific actions to their marriage. We're going to break it down into two kinds of time. The first one is, or two actions. The first one is purposeful time. Purposeful time. This is something that we all need in every relationship. Purposeful time. Not just the incidental time. Incidental time is kind of what happens when you've got a gap in your time and you're doing something with that special person. For instance, at the end of a long day, we finally get our kids off to bed, and Heather and I plop ourselves down in front of the couch and go, whoo, they're gone. Oh. And maybe we're watching TV together, or maybe we're reading side by side, or maybe we're taking care of some last-minute chores around the house, and we're together. But that's not purposeful time. What's that? That's incidental time. We're with each other, and that's important, but it's not purposeful. There's a difference. Purposeful time is when we say, I plan to be with you. I choose to be with you. Purposeful time is when we say to that other person, you are more important than my to-do list, and I'm going to be with you, give you my attention, give you my time. So this is what she does. This is what the woman does. This is what Solomon's wife does. She asks him out on a date. And I think this is great. Ladies, don't wait for the guys to initiate, right? Just you go for it. You initiate. Verse 11. She says, come, my lover. Come, let us go to the countryside. Let us spend the night in the villages. Let us go early to the vineyards to see if the vines have budded, if their blossoms have opened, and if the pomegranates are in bloom. And there I will give my love to you. There I will give you my love. What's she saying? Come on, honey. Let's go to a bed and breakfast. let's spend some time together, just you and me. Let's get on Travelocity, right? Look up the little gnome guy, and he'll give us some ideas about some place we can go. Let's find a hotel downtown where we get a cheap hotel one night, you and me, away from everything, away from kids if you got them, away from work, away from chores, away from the bills, away from stuff. Just you and me. I want to give you my time. Just you and me. And this sounds great. But it means that if you're going to have this kind of purposeful time with your spouse, it means that you're going to have to schedule it in. It means that you're going to have to be purposeful about it. It means you're going to have to plan it. And if you're going to plan for something like this, it means you're going to have to say no to a bunch of other stuff. To say no to your spouse, and yes, your schedule inadvertently tells them, I don't have time for you. You're not my top priority. But when we say no to our schedule and no to our stuff and no to our work and yes to our spouse, then we're telling them, you top my list. You are my priority. Now, the Bible is really clear about what our priorities need to be. Number one is always God. God comes first. That needs to be priority one. If you're married, priority number two then is your spouse. Got it? So if you're married, priority number two becomes your spouse. If you have kids, they become priority number three. Not number two and not number one. So many marriages are destroyed because kids become priority number two and the marriage becomes priority number three. So it's got to be God first, spouse second, kids third, fourth comes work, ministry, those other things, those come fourth. Do you hear the order? And I got to tell you, in my life, I struggle with this. As a pastor, sometimes I get really confused about what is loving God and what is serving the church. And I get things mixed up, and sometimes my family and my wife come second to doing my job, my work, and that's wrong. And I know I'm not the only one who's messed those things up sometimes. So please hear me as I talk about this purposeful stuff. This is important. We need to say yes to the most important first. Yes to the great, which means we're going to have to say no to some good things. We're going to have to say no. I'm sure that when Solomon's bride came to him and said, hey, honey, let's go out to the country. Let's get a bed and breakfast. Let's stay out there. Now, you can read all the innuendo in the middle of that verse, too. She's saying something about being out in the middle of the vineyard and doing something. I don't know. You can read it for yourself. But she's saying, come on, honey, let's go. And he's saying, yes, let's go. And in order for them to go, that means they're going to have to say no to a bunch of other stuff, right? It means that Solomon probably would have had to say no to that weekend hunting trip so he could say yes to be with his bride. It meant that Solomon probably had to say no to going out and playing golf with the guys so he could say yes to his bride. It means that he probably had to say no to adding on to the palace. You know, he's adding an extra room onto the palace, and he's working hard on the weekends, and he doesn't have time for this kind of stuff. He's going to have to say no to that so he can say yes to her. He's going to have to say, the work can wait till Monday. This weekend I'm going to spend with you. You're more important than my work. His wife would have had to say no to things too. She would have had to say no to her girl time with her girlfriends, that time when they were going to go out and hang out and go see a movie and just be together. She was going to have to say no to some friends. For her to go out on the weekend with her husband, she was going to have to say no to working overtime and making some extra money. She was going to have to say no to something that the kids wanted to do. She's going to have to say no to the good. He's going to have to say no to the good in order to say yes to the great, to say yes to the most important things. We need purposeful time. So say no to good so that you can say yes to the most important, purposeful time. And number two, thoughtful acts. We need to do thoughtful acts. We need to do purposeful time, and we need to do thoughtful acts. For most couples, it was really easy as you were getting to know him, as you were getting to know her, it was really easy to do purposeful acts. As you were engaged, it was really easy to do romantic things for each other. And then you get married, and suddenly it's not the top of the list anymore, and doesn't happen in quite the same way that it used to anymore. Now, if you're a newlywed, you might start looking at that and look at your spouse and go, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with us? What's going on? It's life, and we talked about this a number of weeks ago. This is what happens in life. And so we need to plan to do thoughtful acts. It was easy when we were dating to do flowers and love notes and special gifts, but the longer we're married, the less thoughtful acts we do, and it shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be that way. We need to change that. Last chapter here, in last verse we're going to read in chapter 7 here, she starts talking about some mandrakes. This next verse we're going to read, she starts talking about some mandrakes, and you're going to ask, what in the world is a mandrake? Good question. A mandrake is a root, grows in the ground, and you dig it up. And during the time when this was written, mandrakes were like an aphrodisiac. Everybody thought, oh man, get a little mandrake. It's like raw oysters, right? And we're gonna have a special dinner, and it was like their Viagra, okay? So she says, this is what she says. She says in verse 13, she says, the mandrakes send out their fragrance, and at our door is every delicacy, both new and old, that I have stored up for you, my lover. This is a thoughtful act. She's saying, honey, I've been thinking about you. Honey, I wanted to do something special for us. I got some mandrakes, and I went grocery shopping. I got some mandrakes, and I got some other stuff, too, some other delicacies. I got everything you love, honey, everything you love, the stuff you love, and some new stuff for us. This is going to be a great, great getaway. This is going to be a great dinner. This is going to be a great time together. She says, I got these things special for you. I've been thinking about you. And so she does this thoughtful act for him. Thoughtful acts don't need to be big and expensive. In fact, the price point doesn't make them thoughtful. And this is where we get caught up sometimes. We think, oh, that's going to cost me a lot of money, or I need some more money to do something important and thoughtful. But that's not it. In fact, what I have found is the lower the price point, the more creative I've had to be, the less money I've had to spend on it, the more creative I have to be, and the more thoughtful it actually is when we're said and done. Let me give you some examples of really cheap, thoughtful acts, okay? Really cheap, thoughtful acts. I heard this story about this guy, and he said that when he got married, all his life growing up, he always got up and he made the bed in the morning because he wanted the bed to be made. Bed's supposed to be made. That's important to him. Make the bed. His wife just rolls out of bed in the morning. She's like, yeah, whatever. You know, we're not getting, super practical woman. She's like, I'm not getting back in that thing until later today. And when I do, we're just going to mess it up again anyway. So why make the bed, right? And so he makes the bed and she doesn't make the bed. And he looks at her and he says, why not? This is important. And she says, why? This is not important. And so as they're married for years, he's getting up in the morning and she's getting out of bed and he's making the bed. And one day he gets up and she's still in bed and he comes back and she's made the bed. This is new. This is different. This has never happened before. And he pays attention. And he says, what in the world happened here? Who made the bed? She says, I did. He says, why? I thought this wasn't important. And she says, it is to you. I want to make it for you. I've been thinking about you. A thoughtful act. Cost nothing. And so from that day forward, she continued to make the bed for him. That's a thoughtful act. That says, I love you. And every time he looks at that bed, he knows that she loves him. That's a thoughtful act. That's beautiful. And it's free, right? It's free. Hey, the saying that I learned in college, if it's free, it's for me. And that's good stuff right there. So here's another thoughtful act, another example. Every time I go away on a mission trip like I did, you know, going down to San Vicente, or anytime I'm away, what I generally do is I'll take a stack of Post-it notes, and I'll write notes to my wife, and I'll put them all over the house while she's not looking before I leave, right, so that she can find them while I'm gone. So I'm like, I got the refrigerator door open, I'm sticking them on the gallon of milk, right, and I'm sticking them, like, in her sock drawer, and I'm putting anywhere I can think of. I'm putting them, like, under her pillow, anywhere I can think of. I've stuck them on the ceiling before, just all these little random notes about how much I love her and how special she is to me. And I know that she enjoys these. She finds them while I'm gone, and it reminds her again and again that I'm thinking of her and that I love her, and it makes her think about me, and that's good. And I know that she loves them because they're just little scraps of paper. They're just little Post-it notes. But she keeps some of them. So I know they're important to her. Thoughtful act. Now I got to tell you, though, I blew it. I totally blew it. On this last trip out to San Vicente, I was running out the door so fast. I was thinking, I got to do those notes. It was like my phone, right, on the other end. I got a call. Had the best intentions, but I didn't do it. Yeah, I didn't do it. And I've been doing it long enough. She called me on it. She says, where are my Post-it notes, right? Oh, honey, I'm so sorry. So I'm thinking, okay, what can I do? I need her to know that I'm thinking of her. I missed that opportunity. But that doesn't mean that I can't do something now. I need her to know that I'm thinking of her. You may look back on your relationship at this point, and you may say, you know what, I haven't been very thoughtful. Well, don't continue that pattern. Change it. I messed up. I missed it on this trip. But that doesn't mean that I'm going to wait till the next trip to do it again. I'm going to do something else. I need to show her that I'm thinking of her and that I love her. And you can do this too. So thoughtful acts. When you think of something thoughtful, do it. We need to close the gap between good intentions and actions. These are the two big practical takeaways from today. Number one, when you think of something good, say it. Don't hold it back. Too many relationships die of atrophy because they aren't encouraged. When you think of something good, say it. Number two, when you think of something good, do it. Do it. James puts it this way. In the New Testament, James puts it this way. Chapter 4, verse 17, he says, if anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. And applied to what we're talking about today, for us to know the good we ought to do in a relationship and not to do it is wrong. It will hurt. Sin always hurts. Sin always destroys. For us to know the good we ought to do in this relationship, something we need to say, something we need to do, and to not do it, that's wrong. We'll destroy the relationship. James pushes so far as to say, when we know the good we ought to do and we don't do it, that's sin. It's wrong between not just us and that other person, but us and God. And so we need to follow through. We need to close the gap. We need to say it. We need to do it. We can't just think on the inside, I love him. I love her. Instead, we need to show it on the outside. And isn't this what we constantly say in our relationship with God, too? We can't just say, God, I love you. Or we can't just think, God, I love you. We got to follow that up with actions. If we truly love him, it will change the way we live our lives. This is what God did on the cross for us. He didn't just say, oh, Matthew, I love him. He's a good guy. No. God came in the flesh. His name was Jesus Christ. He sacrificed himself on the cross for my sins. He died on the cross a very tangible way. He did it, right? He followed through. He said it and he did it. He died on the cross for my sins to forgive me my sins so I could have a right relationship with God. Didn't just think it. Did it. In our relationship with God, we need to not just think, I love God, but we need to show him. We show God we love him by serving the world. And in our relationships, we need to not just think, I love that person. But we need to say it and show it. When you think of something good to say, say it. When you think of something good to do, do it. Don't hold back. Don't look back and have a bunch of regrets. I wish I would have. I could have. If only. If that's where you're at right now, stuff those away. Get rid of those. And right now, from this day forward, very practical. Say it and do it. Let me pray for us. God, we do thank you for the relationships that are represented in this room today. God, we thank you for the gift that each one of those relationships is. Because the way you love us, you've allowed us to have other people in our lives. And for that, we tell you thank you. And God, we ask that we would be able to show and speak love, speak life into the relationships that we have. And specifically, God, I pray this morning for the marriage relationships in this room. I ask, God, that you would work to restore and to rebuild. I ask, God, for you to give us the courage to say the things that need to be said. I love you because. And God, would you also give us the courage to do the things that need to be done, to rearrange our schedules, to think of thoughtful acts to do, for us to spend time with that person, to make time to be with them. And God, whatever is behind, we want to walk away from. The mistakes that we've made, God, we ask that you would give us, we thank you for the second chances that you give. And God, this morning we do come to you and we ask that you would change our tomorrows for those of us who have messed up our yesterdays. God, I thank you for the reminder this morning that we sang about how you make all things new, that you make things beautiful, that you can make beautiful things grow out of the dust, out of the mistakes, out of the hurt. And so God, we pray this morning that out of the broken relationships represented in this room, that you would make beautiful things grow. God, I thank you for my friends. I thank you for this church family. We thank you that you're our Heavenly Father who loves us. And God, we pray that we could have that kind of love towards other people in our relationships and our lives. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Lord, tithes and offerings this morning. And as we do, I want to draw your attention to that flyer that was in the bulletin this morning. In there are a bunch of pictures and quotes from the team in Mexico from 2 weeks ago. And I got to tell you how proud I am of each one of those team members who went. People sacrificed a lot to be able to go. And some of you sacrificed a lot for them to be able to go. If you've ever given a gift to Good News Church, you know that part of that gift goes towards making trips like this happen and supporting missionaries all around the world. And so if you've ever given a gift to Good News Church, I'd love for you to read those quotes about what God was teaching people and recognize that that time wouldn't have happened without the gifts you've given. Those gifts you've given have changed the lives of those 17 members of the team. And God used those members to change the lives of 24 other people in Mexico. During the 1 week we were in San Vicente, Mexico, we got to see 6 adults come to know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. and we got to see 16 kids come to know Jesus Christ, which is way cool. Yeah, woohoo is right. Would you give God a round of applause for that? Because I'm so excited. On Monday and Tuesday, we got to serve with a doctor in Ensenada. We partnered up with some churches in Ensenada, and we opened up a kind of a health fair, a health clinic, and anybody who came got medical need. We got to hand out glasses to some people for the first time who had never worn glasses before and suddenly could see. It was amazing. As the doctor was meeting with patients, every single person, every single patient got to be prayed with, and then they also got the gospel, how much God loves them, shared with them, and people responded to that. At the same time, we were doing songs and stuff and crafts and games with the kids in the community in the neighborhood. And out of that, kids came to know Jesus Christ. So that was Monday and Tuesday. And then Wednesday and Thursday, we served in a migrant camp. In San Vicente, Mexico, all surrounding this dusty little town, there are thousands and thousands of acres of vegetables, mostly tomatoes, but cucumbers and squash and pumpkins and all sorts of other stuff too. And many of the people who work in those camps are legalized slaves. They work for the landowner, and they get moved around as the landowner sees fit wherever he wants to move them. And they're told they can go home, they can leave whenever they want, just as soon as they pay off the food they've been eating, and as soon as they pay off the house they've been living in, and as soon as they pay off their bus ride they were given to come to work at the camp. As soon as you pay off all that, you can leave and go whenever you want. That sounds like slavery to me. I don't know what you think. And so it's a bunch of people, thousands of people in the San Vicente Valley who are forgotten about by the world. I've told you this before, but when you eat a pizza, you are probably eating tomato sauce from tomatoes that were picked and packed in San Vicente in the San Quintin Valley. When you eat spaghetti sauce, you're probably eating tomatoes that were picked and packed in that corner of the world by people who have been forgotten about. And so we got to go into a migrant camp, and we got to set up a clinic again with the doctor, and we got to do kids and games and songs with the kids. And again, during the course of the week, we saw 6 adults and 16 kids come to know Jesus Christ. It was really cool. I'm always amazed how God can use average, ordinary people like us to see God transform lives. So thank you so much for the way you supported the team financially. Thank you for the way you supported them socially and emotionally. Especially I want to say thank you to the families and the spouses who stayed home to hold down the fort while your loved one went. And also thank you to those of you who prayed while we were gone, supported the team in prayer. We couldn't have done it without you guys. You guys are awesome. So we're going to receive the Lord's tithes and offerings. And again, I just want to tell you, thank you. Know that the gifts you gave made that trip possible and transformed the lives of 24 people. So let's pray. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the chance to be with you. God, we did carve out this time to be with you. That's what Sunday worship service is all about, yes. That you are priority number one. So God, I thank you for this group that's come together to be with you this morning. And God, I thank you for the time that we've had to be with you. And God, this morning we've come to give you our gifts, to tell you thanks for the way you've loved us, that you loved us first. We give you these gifts, and we pray that you would continue to use them to transform people's lives, including ours. God, we know full well that it's not just people in San Vicente who need a relationship with you, but we also know that it's people here in Broomfield and Thornton, in Westminster and Erie, in Superior, in Louisville, in Commerce City and in Brighton, here in the North Denver area. People need you. And so, God, we pray that you would use these gifts to continue to transform people's lives right here in this corner of the world, too. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said,
Amen.